US, where some of the world's leading money managers are warning the collapse of another American bank could lead to a credit crunch and an economic slowdown.
First Republic is the biggest US bank failure since 2008. It invariably brings back memories of the collapse of Lehman Brothers and Bear Stearns.
JPMorgan, one of the world's largest financial institutions, is making headlines as it faces a significant financial challenge. A recent report on JPMorgan Chase's overall financial statement has disclosed substantial losses on securities, with the banking giant now grappling with approximately $40 billion in unrealized bond losses as of the third quarter of this year. This staggering figure represents a 20% increase compared to the preceding quarter. Yet they are not alone in this crisis. Other big banks have been caught up in these troubling times, struggling to stay afloat, even as the smaller banks continue to go under. It appears that this is a game where only the biggest and fittest will survive. A recent report on JPMorgan Chase's overall financial statement has disclosed substantial losses on securities. These updated figures were discreetly tucked away in a footnote within the firm's financial supplement for the third quarter, surpassing the anticipated $34 billion in losses. In a similar vein, Bank of America's latest quarterly report has unveiled a total of $131.6 billion in unrealized losses. While Wells Fargo and Citigroup have also released their third quarter earnings, they have yet to disclose their most recent statistics regarding unrealized losses. However, in the second quarter of this year, Wells Fargo reported $40 billion in unrealized bond market losses, while Citigroup had $25 billion in paper losses. The perils of unrealized losses gained significant attention earlier this year during the collapse of Silicon Valley Bank. The bank's abrupt failure in March was precipitated by the revelation of a $1.8 billion loss stemming from the sale of a portion of its underwater bond portfolio. On the whole, Moody's estimates that the U.S. banking industry is contending with approximately $650 billion in unrealized losses due to the historic downturn in bonds, driven by the Federal Reserve's efforts to maintain higher interest rates over an extended period, as reported by Reuters. Still, the situation is not as straightforward as the Feds are painting it out to be. Market Insider recently reported that the March downfall of Silicon Valley Bank, triggered by plummeting bond prices, may be resurfacing to haunt Wall Street once more. The severe meltdown in the Treasury market has taken a toll on some of the largest financial institutions, causing a decline in the stock prices of prominent players like Bank of America. This resurgence of turmoil has raised concerns that the aftermath of Silicon Valley Bank's bankruptcy is far from over. Treasury bonds, which the government issues to finance its spending, have been on a harrowing trajectory since the onset of the pandemic. Investors have been anxious about rising interest rates and the long-term sustainability of the United States' substantial deficit. The looming threat is becoming increasingly apparent, yet the Federal Reserve appears to underestimate the gravity of the situation. Analysts warn that another bank failure may be imminent. Market veteran Larry McDonald expressed his skepticism, stating in a post on X Sunday, "The Fed's commitment to maintaining interest rates at their current levels until well into 2024 to combat inflation is preposterous. A federal funds rate above 6% could push Bank of America close to insolvency." Citi experienced a modest year-over-year increase in profits, with Wells Fargo's profits surging by 61%, Bank of America's by 20%, and JPMorgan Chase's by 35%. In total, the four major too-big-to-fail banks collectively earned an impressive $30.4 billion during the quarter. In contrast, the results from regional banks have been less robust. While M&T Bank witnessed a 7% profit growth, both U.S. Bancorp and Citizens Financial reported significant profit declines. Additionally, PNC Financial revealed plans to reduce its workforce by 4% after experiencing declines in both profits and revenue in the most recent quarter. The divergence in performance between megabanks and mid-sized to smaller banks is not coincidental. It underscores a new reality in the banking industry, where rising interest rates, historically beneficial for banks in general, are favoring the larger institutions while creating challenges for their smaller counterparts. The traditional advantage for banks in times of rising interest rates has been their ability to raise loan rates by a significantly larger margin than they increase deposit rates. However, this advantage no longer holds true for many regional banks. The ease with which customers can transfer funds from one bank to another has heightened deposit competition. Moreover, customer concerns about a bank's stability have made them more likely to withdraw their deposits if they become apprehensive. To retain customers, banks are compelled to raise interest rates and reduce fees, actions that impact their profits negatively. These challenges are less pronounced for megabanks. While they must still contend with price competition and have raised deposit interest rates, their too-big-to-fail status means that their customers are less worried about the bank's solvency. Consequently, they can offer lower interest rates on deposits and charge higher fees compared to smaller banks. This is why, despite experiencing a decline in deposits, their net interest income has continued to rise rather than fall. In August, Reuters reported that the swift collapse of Silicon Valley Bank during the spring unveiled an inconvenient reality. Some U.S. banks lack the readiness to secure loans from the Federal Reserve when the need arises. An analysis reveals that this issue is most pronounced among the nation's smallest banks. Silicon Valley Bank, a prominent top 20 bank with over $210 billion in assets at the time of its failure, had an insufficient reserve of collateral. In the year leading up to its demise, it had not conducted any testing of its access to the discount window, which is the channel through which the Fed disperses emergency loans. The Federal Reserve, in a review of the bank's downfall published in April, stated that this lack of preparedness may have contributed to the rapidity of Silicon Valley Bank's collapse. Meanwhile, JPMorgan Chase Bank is taking proactive steps to remain a too-big-to-fail bank. Inside Business reported in November that JPMorgan Chase and AMP Company is actively exploring potential partnerships to expand its private credit business and expedite its entry into the thriving leveraged finance sector. Individuals familiar with the matter revealed that discussions with potential partners, including sovereign wealth funds, pension funds, endowments, and alternative asset managers, have commenced in recent months and are in the preliminary stages. These insiders preferred not to disclose their names, considering the confidential nature of the situation. The specific structure and terms of a prospective partnership have yet to be determined, and it remains a possibility that more than one partner may be chosen. JPMorgan has reached out to some firms, and others have expressed interest in collaborating with the bank. JPMorgan's aim is to secure third-party capital to complement the over $10 billion in balance sheet cash it has already earmarked for its private credit strategy, which it initiated in the past year. A larger pool of capital would empower the bank to compete more effectively with industry leaders such as Blackstone Inc., Apollo Global Management Inc., and Ares Management Corp. by facilitating greater commitments and participation in larger transactions. Meanwhile, the constant turmoil in the financial and economic sphere points to the fact that the Federal Reserve really needs to go back to the drawing board and fast. The financial landscape is ever-evolving, and as we look to the future, there's a growing sentiment that governments might need to reconsider their traditional role of bailing out central banks. Historically, governments have come to the rescue of central banks during financial crises, but for the United States, the prevailing economic chaos raises intriguing questions about the dynamics of financial stability and responsibility as far as the Federal Reserve is concerned. The idea of a government in the future refusing to bail out the Fed represents a significant shift in the traditional relationship between central banks and governments. As the financial landscape evolves, some financial analysts insist that a time will come when the government will have to damn the consequences. The Federal Reserve has come under increased public scrutiny in recent years. Calls for greater transparency, accountability, and scrutiny of their actions have grown louder. This has led to a reevaluation of the extent to which governments should be willing to bail out central banks when their actions come under question. Critics also argue that the Feds may have contributed to financial bubbles and economic imbalances and are now questioning the wisdom of the government offering unconditional support to them, especially if their policies are deemed responsible for economic instability. With the growing debt of the state and an ever-increasing appetite for credit, it appears that the time is growing closer when governments will be under so much pressure to exercise fiscal responsibility, particularly when it comes to budget allocation, that bailing out the Feds will be too much of a costly endeavor. While this shift may bring about chaos, perhaps it may also open a new chapter for a more prudent and accountable financial system. It could encourage the Feds to make more cautious decisions and prioritize economic stability over risky ventures. There may also be a stronger push for innovation in monetary policy and risk management to minimize the need for bailouts. Generally, the Federal Reserve may become more conservative in its approach to monetary policy, which could mitigate the potential for speculative bubbles and financial crises. In this ever-evolving financial landscape, the future of government involvement in the Federal Reserve and central banking institutions remains a topic of significant debate. As the Feds face increased public scrutiny and calls for greater accountability, a day may come when a government's traditional role of bailing out central banks is reevaluated. While this would undoubtedly present challenges, it also holds the potential to usher in a new era of accountability and fiscal responsibility. The pressure on governments to exercise prudence in budget allocation and ensure responsible financial governance may ultimately lead to a more stable and resilient financial system. As governments grapple with growing debts and the need for financial responsibility, the idea of a future government that may not rush to the rescue of the Federal Reserve brings into focus the evolving dynamics of financial stability and responsibility. It remains to be seen how this current financial turmoil, with the government, the Feds, and the banks at the forefront, will play out.